Yeah. No, like, I'm ready, dude.
Fight! Church! Fight! Church! Fight! Church!
Y'all give it up one more time, please, for Mr. DJ Spark on the ones and twos. You see, we got real turntables up there. Okay, who's never been to Fight Church before? Just raise your hand real quick if you've never been to Fight Church. That's cool. Raise your hand if you just came because you got so thirsty for being across the street. Yeah, it's quite the cottonmouth day. That was an abrupt end to the applause. Crowd is on it. Just moves. Okay, so I guess the easiest way to start the show, the way we do it every week, is for me to explain in a nutshell what exactly Fight Church is. We're like a not-so-secret secret society.
I know that.
We're kind of like the X-Men. Like, everyone that's, like, attracted to this kind of place has some cool, well, most of them have some cool little shit they know about or some little way they get ahead in life that can be helpful to each other's causes. So we got this little thing we do where we just come together. So I'm getting off track. So the fight in Fight Church doesn't really represent violence.
I hear you.
The fight in Fight Church represents the bonding commonality of the mutual struggle, which is real. Fighting the forces of gravity. Ladies and gentlemen, an engineer right there, Mr. Ryan McKenzie. Murdering chairs. I said it doesn't really represent violence. Okay, so look. So the fight in Fight Church represents the bonding commonality of the mutual struggle.
I know that.
A lot of people think that they have like individual problems. You don't. You have individual symptoms, and we all got the same fucking problem. So it's like a disease or like alcoholism. If your father's an alcoholic in your family, your relationship with your dad is going to be different, or the dad's relationship with the mom is going to be fucked up. But it's going to be different than the dad's relationship with the son or with the daughter or with his coworkers or with his community, right? But the root problem in all those bad relationships is who's an alcoholic. Well, we deal with that same thing. We have a diseased societal model. You know, everything in our society right now is fucking upside down and backwards. Like, things that should be up or down, things that should be left or right, things that should be embraced or trivialized, and things that should be trivialized or embraced. It's absolutely fucked up. And the only way to fix that is to work together. because nobody's going to come fucking save us, yo. We got to save each other. You know, there's not going to be anybody. I mean, Jesus might come save us if Jake Zimmerman brings him.
What are we talking about?
But other than that, you know, we're kind of on our own out here. So then that's like where the church part comes in. So we're not really religious. Like, we're like way more over the top than declaring some religion, you know. But anywhere where people are gathering together under a roof to plan some benevolent shit where community is the antidote for the problem, that's Fight Church. All right, so I don't know if that fucking made sense. Let's just move on. All right, happy 420 day, Portland. What the fuck, yo? You fucking potheads. You're all like, just like walking around all slow and shit. Hey! Me too, though. Me too. So forgive me if I just forget what I'm talking about from time to time. Because I got fucking dabbed out earlier. You ever like took a dab so big that you like coughed through your eye holes? Because like your mouth and your nose and your ear canals aren't big enough. So you just like, and your eyes are stinging. And then you're high forever and you get all paranoid. And you fucking think everybody's going to sucker punch you. You're just like fucking sitting there. Whenever somebody walks by you really fast, you're just like, whoa, bro. Don't fucking walk by me that fast. And then you get super paranoid. Like fucking, maybe everybody doesn't really like my cracks. Maybe they're all just lying to me. You guys wouldn't do that. So yeah, I didn't dress up today because I also waked and baked. Or woke and baked.
I knew
woke
that.
And baked. I don't know how to say it. And it was hot. So I just put on my usual 420 shirt to speak to the institution of the fucking police state. The self-sustaining prison industrial complex. So don't think this is about fucking getting stoned and being happy. This is about people really going to prison. On that note, remember, keep your fucking fingers crossed. Because hopefully this will be our last illegal 420 ever. Right? And they got a couple months to get it together. So keep the political pressure on. Don't get lazy because it's not the cause du jour. Like, we got to keep that pressure on. And shout out to all our people that are actively, like, in Salem and actively addressing and harassing the legislators. And shout out to that lady for looking at me weird. Shit, you know? I don't really got that much more to talk about. I really want to eat some fucking meat, though. I want to eat some meat so bad. So bad. Look, I've been sitting here. I came early to do some prep. And those sons of bitches over there have just been barbecuing the most bombest ribs. And it's just been going like this, like on a cartoon with a little finger. You know what I'm saying? Then there's one from the other way that's for cocaine. It's going, dude, come closer to Woodstock. And I'm fucking torn just trying to get my shit done. Seriously though, shout out to the other spot over there for their hospitality. Always shout out to Sirius Extracts for all the bomb dabs. That's really nice of them. I just can't fuck with that shit no more, man. Fuck. I got it. When you have to get drunk to come down, you know what I'm saying? Like, I ate a banana and a burrito. I ate a burrito too. I ate legumes. I had to. It was $8, though. They really fucking jerk you when you're a vegetarian. Okay, y'all ready to start the show? Enough of me. More of them. What time is it? Really? We're perfect on time. Perfect on time. This just in. For the first time in months, we're getting out of the monologue on time. Breaking news. More at 11. I don't really think that was breaking news. This just in, breaking news. DJ Spark doesn't really know what breaking news is. That is breaking news. Hey, you know what, real quick? You know, before I start the show, I don't want to put it on my Facebook because I'm at a moment in my life where I'm really not trying to make enemies with news stations right now, right? But last night, man, I couldn't get the goddamn television off fast enough, and Fox News snagged me, right? right? You know what they did? Like, it went, like, right from the end of, like, that show about the last man on the earth. And I was like, hey, that's funny, blah, right? And then, boom, Fox News comes in and goes, 168 people dead in an explosion. And I was like, fuck. Pause. 20 years ago on this day. Oh, my God, I was so fucking mad. Ugh. Breaking news. That's not breaking news either. Fox News fucking sucks. Okay, let's do it. Spark, play that other music. Y'all got to give it up one more time for DJ Spark so we can start the show. And now... none of our guests are here. All right, well, if they were here, this is what it would sound like. And now, celebrating his fifth year as a stand-up comedian stunt double for an actual stand-up comedian, but still feeling good enough about his shit to come up on and film a half an hour special set live at Fight Church, Mr. Patrick Thomas Perkins is not here. Seeing as how it's 4:20, there was only one logical musical guest that I could pick for this evening. The group that has headlined the Hemp Stock Festival for the last 4 years in a row. They let me in backstage for free. They're the super homies. They'll be here any minute. They're probably getting dabbed out. Ladies and gentlemen, Mrs. Bad Habitat is not here. Our other guest says he doesn't want you to go to hell, but he keeps coming up with reasons that you should. Today's reason is that you smoked the devil's lettuce. You want to know what the real devil's lettuce is?
What are we talking about? Lettuce.
Like lettuce. That's the real devil's lettuce. Like whenever you get some shit, like this is all fucking lettuce. You know what else is the devil's lettuce? Rice. Fuck rice, man. Charge me $8 and my burrito's almost all fucking rice and devil's lettuce. Sorry. Wow. Somebody has an umbrella on indoors.
I know that.
That's bad.
I mean, how silly is that?
Dude, you're gonna get struck by lightning.
I know that.
Crazy. Hey, get a camera on those people if they do get struck by lightning. That one looks like they already did.
I hear you.
All right, and our special guest tonight, I couldn't pick anybody that has a more important message right now than my next two guests. They want to sell pot to your kids or some shit like that. So they can smoke it with fucking pinball.
What else do you want to
know? My next guest is the national co-founder of the Parents for Pot movement and the Oregon coordinator for the local chapter of the Parents for Pot movement. Miss Anna Diaz and Mr. Barney Merman, come on down. It's time for Give That Kid Weed. Y'all give it up for DJ Wheels over there doing some producing and shit.
Hey, all right. Yay!
And then give it up for our engineer who just keeps jumping from chair to chair. Ooh. Ninja Rule number 67. If the ground is hot lava or if it is not hot lava, jumping on chairs is better.
I know that.
We doing all right? We always have this moment right here. What camera are we on? What camera are we on? Camera one? Camera three? And then you got that one over there. How you guys doing? Let's make sure your microphones work.
It's working good. Excellent. Thanks for having me.
This one is also working quite well. Nicely done, engineers.
Right. Josh McCoskey came and helped us with that. Oh, speaking of which, Josh McCoskey and Naomi and myself just reached agreement for the Diva Project? For Naomi's music crew. They all got like seven names. They just keep rotating people in. Okay, look, all I know is Naomi and Josh are both in on Food Wars 8. Food Wars 8. We've been doing this shit for 8 freaking years. And that's going to be on Father's Day. That way everybody who's not with their kids can feel bad and just kind of get drunk with us. All the deadbeat parents will just show up. But it'll be at the Clinton Street Theater, which is pretty friggin' awesome. They need the support. They're trying to stay afloat in a competitive business, which involves a lot of remodels and rebuilds and retrofitting and seismic upgrading and shit like that. So we're going to try to help them. You guys ever been to the Clinton Street Theater? Did you ever buy acid from me in front of the Rocky Horror Picture Show? Sorry. Some voters might have forgot. They're like, oh, that dude. Yes, I will vote for that guy. Yes.
The guy that sold the acid at the Clinton Street.
Yes.
Wow.
I like that dude.
Should put that in the brochure.
So let me reset who my guests are right now. This is Miss Anna Diaz. This is Mr. Barney Merman.
Hi, guys.
And they're both with the Parents for Pot movement.
Thanks for having us.
So, I guess before we go into what is Parents for Pot, why don't each one of you take a moment and just give us a quick, you know, half paragraph or whatever about who you are and how you got to a movement, you know what I'm saying? And then we'll bring those together and go ahead.
Okay, my name is Anna Diaz. I've been a cannabis activist since 2001 when I moved to Portland and found out after living pretty freely growing up in Alaska that people in the real world didn't have the same freedoms that I did. So I didn't have a job and I was new in town and I was looking for some weed and I figured I better go to a normal meeting because somebody there would probably know who had some if they didn't have it there. And I was right. But also what I found was a group of people that were totally awesome and really needed my help. So I started registering voters for them at the Million Marijuana March in 2001, and that's when I got bit by the bug, and I've been an activist ever since. I co-founded Oregon Normal and the Oregon Medical Cannabis Awards with Madeline Martinez, and I am the 2011 recipient of National Normal's Pauline Sabin Award, which is given to women who show leadership in the cannabis movement. And then, thank you. Yeah, that's what I said. I was pretty thrilled too, thank you. And then I became one of the founders of Parents for Pot because I think that parents are, it's more even, as much as cannabis consumers are disenfranchised as a community, parents are disenfranchised within that community. They lose their children. I mean, what could be worse? So when I first heard about Parents for Pot and it was just barely starting up, I asked them if I could help, and they said yes, and there we went. So, and then it grew from there. But I knew Barney before that, so Barney, it's your turn.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Anna. Give a little hand for Anna Diaz. She wears many hats and has been a powerful supporter of a lot of organizations.
Hey, man. when you tell us how you got here, you have to make sure that you mention that we worked together at the YMCA in 1991.
Yeah.
All right?
Absolutely.
All right, who took swim lessons at the YMCA over there before? Nobody? Nobody? See, that's why I got to be the mayor. You guys don't even know about that shit, man. Y'all ain't never been on no hydro tubes. Who's been on a hydro tube before?
Oh, yeah. Eastport Plaza.
Okay. I'll vote for you guys then.
My name is Barney. I'm the Oregon chapter chairman of Parents for Pot. And we are a fantastic group of individuals. And how we got to this point, I'll rewind. Well, I'll go all the way back, before 1991.
When you were just a wee, Barney.
I was in juvenile detention and in a Donald E. Long home, and I got in trouble on my way out the door, and they even tacked on some community service and all this other stuff I had to do. So I ended up starting some community service for the Oregon Food Bank. And I was putting together food boxes and delivering them and helping deliver them, and I just could not believe there's a big stereotype on who needs food. I'm sure you know about a lot of this, but you know, I'm bringing food to people who just couldn't make ends meet. Both working parents, hardworking people, you know, with a couple kids, just trying to make ends meet. You know, so I really got started into activism pretty early. I ended up working at the YMCA with Jesse.
Was that community service?
It started off as community service, and I worked into a job. In fact, we had the Outer
East
Community Service
Center. I
didn't
even know I was cohabitating.
Some of
the felon.
Some of the kids that went through that program, you know, ended up working there too.
Right, I was just gonna say, man, if y'all haven't been to the YMCA, you haven't been on the hydro tubes. Who's been to the Donald E. Long home?
There we go.
Yeah,
we got one.
I think she's just raising her hand for everything.
Whoop whoop.
So, I think she really is just raising her hand for everything. Who's just raising their hand for everything?
I don't feel so alone. So we had a long run. We had a long run with different charities and stuff as I grew up and worked with the Outer East Youth Service Center. And some of the guys that were in there, we started some stuff where they give away stuff to teen moms and different types of organizations. And I've always tried to follow that path. And I got a call about three years ago now, somebody had canceled at the World Famous Cannabis Cafe for a Brave Michaela benefit, which I had no idea. I didn't have my OMMP card. I didn't even smoke. At that time, I was...
Really?
Yeah, at that time, I was between...
Man,
I was
Barney
between
is just
stuff.
Full of secrets.
Whoa. It was like 2 years, probably the worst 2 years of my life. No, I'm just kidding. but so I got called in. They said, hey, we had a band cancel. Can you guys come do it? And we had a venue cancel. Like the week before, and we were really excited because we've been working hard, and so we're like, "Yeah, we'll come down and do it," you know. And they had Brave Michaela in on the big screen, and she's like finger dancing, you know. And to me, it really struck me having two daughters, you know, that a family would even have to go through this in this day and age, that they have to have community events just to put food on the table and make ends meet, you know. I'm like, well, what is this? So you know, I jumped in, got involved with that, and then a few months later, over at Frank and Aaron's, I saw Michaela, and there was a bunch of other kids there. And this kid is bouncing off the walls, healthier and happier than any of the kids that are in this room. We're talking about a girl who had almost a basketball-sized mass in her chest. And so I started to see the powerful medicine at work. And I kind of was introduced through that group of people to other children and other things that I've seen. And it becomes one of those responsibility things. Like, I never considered myself to want to be a cannabis activist or want to be, you know, a voice for that kind of thing. But what happens is you get a little spark of responsibility when you actually see it work and you see what it does for people. You have a duty to start sharing that. And it not only does it blow you away, but you actually have a personal responsibility to help and try to share that information and be part of the truth about cannabis. So
what are we talking about? We're talking about cannabis.
We're talking about cannabis, man. Happy 420.
We're talking about cannabis activists. Good setup. So let's backtrack there just a little bit. So you just kind of passed over the fact that that little girl had a basketball-sized tumor in her chest.
Yeah, basketball-sized mass in her chest.
And then you're inferring that it went away?
I'm inferring that she is in complete remission, cancer-free, chemo-free.
She just had her one-year anniversary, cancer-free.
One-year anniversary.
Within the last few months. 9 years old. She looks amazing. She looks great.
She's our princess.
Yeah.
There's been several handfuls of kids.
I was just going to say, I don't think that she's the only child who is being treated with pot. But okay, my question is, how are you treating her? I'm sure her little fingers aren't rolling up doobies.
Right. Right. Well, contact high only goes so far in the medical application, so we really have to concentrate things down and what we, you know, what depending on the illness that the person's suffering from, of course, there'd be a different recipe that would be right for them. But basically, we're using concentrated cannabis oil, the full extract cannabis oil, the whole plant extract, and using that as medicine. You know, a lot of times, if you or I were to get really sick, and they said, hey, if you chew on this South American tree bark, and all you eat is this, and you take these big giant pills, and you let us shoot you full of radiation, then you're going to get better, and it might work. But you're not going to get a three-year-old to eat tree bark. You know what I'm saying? You're not going to get a three-year-old to take horse pills and sit still for 4 hours of chemotherapy.
Adults eat tree bark?
No way!
I've heard of weirder stuff, you know, when people want to...
Yeah. So then what? She just, like, does she put in her food?
They mix it in with food. They have capsules. Most of the severe cases... are all taken orally. There's different ways for different people, whatever is best for them. But oral capsules mixed with a little bit of coconut oil and some other stuff. And then also just adding in also, you know, a very natural-based diet of organic foods and exercise and all the regular stuff. You know, and then adding in a powerful medicine on top of that that gives you complete healing. There's a lot of information out there. And I'm not a doctor, but if you were to research a little bit on the endocannabinoid system and see what this nutrient is nourishing and what it does for the body, you might see yourself going, well, everybody needs that, you know. But
because everybody does need it.
Everybody does need it. Under deficient.
What kind of percentage is it? I mean, that's an extract, right? So is that just like a high CBD?
I'm telling you, these kids in the programs.
No, you need both.
Go ahead.
Both?
You need THC and CBD to get the full... health benefit.
And the THAs and the CBAs, right?
All of it. You need the complete plant.
There's over 500 compounds.
So the really good way to go is actually raw, juiced cannabis is what I know Michaela was drinking every day, three times a day. And that stuff is nasty, I'm here to tell you. But also there's something, I mean, you can feel, I've only drank it one time because sweet little Erin Wallace, I don't know if she's in here, but... Erin made me a little
maybe she's
sample
watching
of it.
At home. What camera?
Right. Sirius Extracts. Mrs. Sirius Extracts made me a little thing of it, a shot of it. And about a half an hour later, I really noticed that I had a lot more energy, and I could just feel, I don't know, the health coursing through my veins kind of. It was an amazing feeling. So I could see how it could be really healing. But that's another way that they also ingest it is raw leaf juice.
So the kid gets freaking high, though,
no,
right?
They don't.
No? They don't. No, the raw juice is it's not activated yet, so you get a lot of nutrients.
How do you take those capsules, though?
When you take the capsules, they do. In fact, we have some children in the program that would make, you know, Cheech and Chong look like lightweights the way they drop this oil. You know,
I was going to say, kids got to be funny as shit stoned, right?
They color pretty good, you know. They color better than me stone. It's really pathetic.
Oh dear.
So, of course, if something's miraculous but not regulated by the FDA, they got to find some way to generate money from it. So, how legal is this stuff?
In Oregon?
I was gonna say, comma. In Oregon and across the nation. Like, I remember we spoke about a month ago about the mom from Indiana, right?
Kansas.
No, the one from Indiana that was going to lose her kid if she went back. And then there was just that lady yesterday or whatever in Kansas whose kid schooled everybody.
Yeah, he just spoke up at school. He spoke up about the misinformation. and they raided the mom's house and took the kid away without his parents. Oh my gosh. Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, back to the question.
You're grounded, you little snitch.
There's various ways that they're putting pressure on. I know in Washington, I've been focusing on watching what's going on in Washington, and they put a little bit of pressure on these guys, even the recreational shops and stuff. You're not going to find RSO in decarb oils and the higher potency medicinal ways of taking it. There's so much oversight through the government that the recreational shops we're not even going to bother with it. And so that leaves a lot of, I mean, they're just disenfranchising a lot of people from the medicine side of it, you know. So that's something we're watching closely.
So let me guess how that works. So since that's a viable alternative to the pharmaceutical industry lobbyists pressure the legislators to restrict the production.
Sure.
Right, but can you still produce it if you're a medical patient in Washington?
Yes. No. Right. In Washington, I'm not sure what's going on there because they just had that.
Here, we don't know either what's going on here.
No, I do know what's going on
here.
Do you?
That was going to be my next question.
I know what's going on here. You want me to tell you?
Yeah.
You know what? I bet you Barney knows too, but he keeps so many secrets through our lives, I found out.
I want to hear from Anna.
No.
Yeah, please
tell
us.
Here's what I do know. As far as the OMMP is concerned, patients, caregivers, and growers can make oil, they can make concentrates, all that stuff, they can make dabs, everything. It's allowed in the dispensaries, and there you go. But if you want to talk about, but there's always a huge but, and it's the same but that it's been forever, and that
is
on indeed, we are talking huge. And that is, on the federal level, it's all still illegal. And that's why every time I go out and get the opportunity to say it, I say this. Contact your national representatives. Let them know that it's time to end cannabis prohibition. Earl Blumenauer has been putting a bill in every year since I moved here in 2001, and I'm sure before that. But they never go anywhere because we can't get enough people to rally across the country. And so that is why I think it's really important to share the stories that we have about the successes like Brave. Mama. Anyway, we need to contact our national representatives and tell them that it's time to end cannabis prohibition, and it's time for them to just do it and to just stop messing around. It needs to be descheduled off the Controlled Substances Act completely, and then we wouldn't have any of these problems at all. Kids could get the medicine that they need. People who want to get high like me could get high. People who want it for medical reasons could use it for medical reasons, and nobody would go to jail. And while we're at it, let's pull everybody out of prison that's in there for a frickin' plant.
Absolutely.
That's what I say.
I was on a radio show, and they asked, well, what are we going to do with them? We don't have jobs for our returning soldiers. Wait a minute. Are you trying to justify keeping people in prison because we don't have jobs? We have an industry that's starting here, an entire industry movement that's taking place. You know, and a lot of people, when this Measure 91 came through, a lot of people turned to their friends and neighbors, and they start high-fiving and hugging each other. Guess what? That's a starting pistol. We have a lot of work to do to ensure that this stuff sticks and that we have clear and safe access and that this is decriminalized. This is ridiculous. What's the black market value of tomatoes?
Expensive.
There isn't one.
Expensive, man. Tomatoes are expensive.
They are expensive.
So
even on the black market, I guess.
So okay, you gave an awesome question or you gave an awesome answer to a different question, not the one I wanted to ask. Okay, let me set this up by saying that Jake Neely and his band of internet friends are really upset with me and the proponents of the legalization movement. And they're pointing big fingers and saying, I told you so, I told you so. And the one thing I want to just make clear before we extend into this conversation is that we live in 2015 where people are looking for any fucking tiny thing to make a story about that somebody will click on the fucking article so that they can sell Google ad space. You know what I'm saying? Journalism isn't always sincere or genuine or really designed to educate the fucking consumer of said media.
Absolutely.
Right? So in the old days, you would have never even aired a story about some crazy proposal that some freaking one representative proposed to committee. Right? I know I've said this like 10 times on the show. Don't believe anything until it comes out of committee. Like, everything goes in committee. But still, it's obvious that just like in past years, the OMMP program is under attack. But strange twist of fate, it's kind of under attack by the same people that used to be the good guys, right? You know what I'm saying? They made a lot of money. They made a lot of money off the backs of patients. And then once they made that money off the backs of patients, they were like, hey, check this out. We got all this extra money to form a fucking political action committee. And now we can start lobbying, right? Now we can start lobbying people and throwing our fucking weight around, just like the pharmaceutical companies are doing, right? But it's just politics. So I want you to speak to, if the vote was today, how would you vote and why?
I'll start it.
Go ahead.
Sure. Well, you know, if the vote was today, there's a lot of grandiose ideas that have been floating around, and a lot of people are taking a lot of time and their own personal energy and invested in businesses and stuff like that to help the, you know, within their community. But if the vote was today, I would still vote yes. I would still vote to legalize. I think that if we can keep the working guy walking down the street with a little bit of weed in his pocket out of jail or from getting harassed and getting, you know, and having, or even maybe a younger person who, you know, has a full life in front of them, you know, looking at time or having marks on their record over a plant that's much safer than all the alternatives I could think of, you know. And so I would still vote yes. It may not be the best for different groups, and there's a lot of people who have different opinions on that, but I still am thinking about overall having more medicine available to people and overall having less people going to jail. So I'm going to vote yes every time.
What if the lobbyist efforts go through and the OLCC takes over the OMMP program? Is that something you're worried about? Kind of worried about? Giving little attention to? Where are you at with that, Anna?
Well, I was just talking to somebody about this earlier today.
On a different talk show?
No, just in their backyard. No, no. This is all exclusive Fight Church
all right.
TV.
Thank you. You got it.
You're killing me.
But anyway, and the OLCC has sent recommendations to the legislature about things that they would like to see happen. And one of the things that they made really clear was that they're not really in favor of taking on the medical marijuana program. They want to keep them separate unless the medical marijuana program is willing to change its parameters to include that seed to sale thing that they're going to do recreationally, which I think would be really stupid because we've already got everything in place. Everything's working for the medical program right now. I mean, the medical program that I remember in 2001 when I first came here where patients could only have an ounce and we could only have 3 ounces at home. And come on, we've come a long way, baby, right? So I don't want to see any of that go away. And I'm really happy that a lot of people agree with me about that have the time to go to the legislature this session, because unfortunately I haven't been able to get down there. But we do have some people that are representing us pretty well down there. And I think that the medical community has shown that we can kick ass at the legislature when we went and got our limits raised from 3 ounces to 24 ounces back in 2005, I believe it was, with Senate Bill 1085, when we really kicked ass. And also electing Attorney General Ellen Rosenblum. I think that the medical community showed that we've got the cojones to do what needs to be done. And I think that there are people down there representing us that can do it. So, and also knowing that the OLCC is not really all that thrilled about taking on the medical marijuana program unless they comply in the same way, which I think that that's ridiculous. You're talking about businesses that are already established having to invest, you know, I don't know how much more money it would cost to get one of those systems, but I'm sure they're not cheap. So it doesn't seem viable to me personally. And what I'm seeing is that the people who are speaking on our behalf, are that's what they're representing to our legislators. And I'm happy with that. So that's what I think. We'll see. I mean, it all remains to be seen.
They really shot down my make it like a mocha stand idea. That didn't get very far.
You're what?
Make it like a mocha stand. I thought I'd maybe just drive through and roll the window down, you know, but
No.
Not yet. Maybe a few more years. I'm not a real bad, real big fan of the OLCC and how they operate. Unless there's anyone from the OLCC here, then you're probably pretty cool. But I'm not a real big fan on how they operate, but I'm not too worried. You know, I mean, a lot of the strong voices in the community, you know, get together on these issues. And that's one of the reasons why Measure 91 was really important to me, because I wanted everyone to see that, yeah, if we all grab on each other's hands and pull each other together, we can make some monumental legislation pass, you know.
And we did.
And that's one of the reasons why I was such a strong supporter then, even though there was controversy around the bill and the housing-wise. The bottom line is there's going to be more weed for everyone.
I like that. More weed for everyone. I should run for office. That'll be mine.
Okay, the last thing I'm going to ask you, because this is going to be asked of me next week. So it's nice everybody got on the rah-rah. And now it's legalized. But now it's kind of shitting on the backs of the growers who have been providing you weed this whole time, who've been risking their ass, who've been going to jail this whole time. And they're still kind of getting screwed, you know what I'm saying? Like, the government's going to come in and regulate your shit. And the people that went to jail aren't getting let out of jail. The people aren't getting their fucking records expunged. They're not getting their fucking rental histories back, you know what I'm saying? So, like, speak to, like, once we got here, all right, and like you said earlier, once we got here, it was just a starting pistol.
Right, we're not done by a long shot.
Right, okay, so knowing that we have to protect the people that got us this far, and Jake Neely will be on our show next week to yell at me for helping the past 91, because he thinks I totally screwed him over, which I still completely stand by my vote. If you've ever had the cops kick your fucking hotel door in and pull fucking guns on you in front of your kid because you had a dirty UA, you might want to fucking shut down the machine that fucking produces fucking UAs. So forgive me for fucking voting yes. So what's the next step, guys? And then I'll let you out of here. What's the next step? How do people plug in? What's the next step with Parents for Pot? What's the next step with the movement in general?
Well, the next step for Parents for Pot Oregon is we're going to represent at the Global Cannabis March on May 2nd. But it's a fantastic opportunity for everybody to come out. We almost got this thing done. You can come out and come out of the closet and come out and hold arms with all of us and walk down the road. And we're gonna make a circle around you and protect you.
Is that Mexico City or Paris?
All over the world.
It's the
Global Cannabis March.
May 2nd.
May 2nd. We're downtown Portland.
Yes.
Yeah.
11 to 6, I think they're going. They're going to have vendors all day. They're going to have bands all day. I'll be speaking. Barney will be speaking.
Yeah.
Nikki will be speaking. They're going to march at 4 o'clock, which is going to be new this year. So that's pretty exciting. I'm excited about it. Yeah, it'll be fun, and it'll be a great opportunity.
At 4:20 in the middle of a march, everybody's just going to fog out on the street somewhere? That's pretty bad. I mean, you're not going to not do it.
It could happen.
Stranger things have happened downtown than that.
No evidence. Create no evidence.
You'd think with that rowdy mob, they'd want some smoke flying, but.
Well, what if people out there want to give their kids or other kids weed? Because remember, stoned kids have to be fucking funny.
I think stoned parents is a better way to go myself.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Stone parents are good too, absolutely.
But as far as Parents for Pot goes, on the national level, what we're trying to do is remove the stigma from parents who do choose to use cannabis, whether it's recreationally or medically. We think it's time for parents to be able to come out of the closet and be able to stand up and say, you know what? I'm a parent who smokes pot, and for me, I know it made me a better parent. I believe it really did.
Absolutely.
And because I'm a lot more fun when I'm high. Let me tell you. And I remember my son saying, uh-oh, look out, mom's out of weed. So I know that it was true in my life. But the thing is, parents are the people who have the least amount of support in the cannabis movement. And so what we wanted to do when we started this was provide a place, a resource where parents can go, parents of all kinds, not just parents who have children who are sick, but parents whose kids are in jail, parents who are in jail themselves, parents who, every kind of parent, that weed touches us all in some way. And when something bad happens, we want it to be the go-to place where you can figure out what to do next. So if you go to our website, www.parents4pot.org, we have a resource list there that has a section of what to do if your child is sick. And we have a ton of medical resources there for parents who are looking for resources for things that can help their children. We have resources for what if your kid has gone to jail. We have resources there for what to do about financial aid. Because kids that get busted for weed can't get financial aid, you guys. How stupid is that?
So legal resources, too. Yeah, a lot of legal resources, too.
Yeah, so check it out. And then we have a blog there where I told the story of my pregnancy where I smoked weed while I was pregnant and my child is fine except for the fin on the top of his head. But the Mohawk hides it. No, I'm kidding. But
nothing like anecdotal evidence.
Right.
Okay, right now we got 1 minute left. Okay. Just a bonus, the final round. I want you guys to tell me your top five strains of pot right now.
Oh, blue cheese, Northern Lights number 5. Top five strains?
Weed so good, you have no idea what it's called.
Dude. Blue Dream.
All right. Green Crack. Ahead.
Blue Dream, Green Crack, Jack Hare, Train Wreck, White Widow.
Oh.
All day long.
Right, you guys, please put your hands together for Anna Diaz and Barney Berman for Parents for Pot.
And I do have some literature if anybody's interested. Thank you for having us.
Thank you so much for having us. Here's some sound.
Oh, yes. Bless you. Bless you. Bless you.
I make that on my kitchen table.
Okay, guys, check this out. We're going to take a brief smoke break. We're going to be back in about 15 minutes with my man Jake Zimmerman over there, who wants to tell you a story about the devil. So, we'll be back in about 15 minutes. Bad Habitat should be somewhere around here. If you see them, let them know to stick around because I don't want to have to find them because Spark is a jerk when the schedule goes crazy. Hey, if you want to pick up one of those first run, I told you about Habitat in the house. If you want to pick up one of those first run Spomberg for Mayor shirts, the exclusive first run blue ones, they're over here. Just find me your wheels or something. $20 a piece. When the blue ones are gone, the blue ones are gone. And then you have to front. Then you have to front like, ah, man. You got the purple one.
I mean, how silly.
Y'all get up for traffic right there. Bad Habitat in the house. All right. Cigarette break. We're going to come back with my man Jake Zimmerman. Wheels want Spark to push the applause button. Y'all give it up one more time for DJ Spark. DJ Wheels over there. And your bartender, Ian. And your other bartender, Cody. Am I forgetting anybody? Y'all give it up for yourselves one time. Fuck lettuce. Yes, yes, y'all. Are our cameras back to normal? Are we back to normal yet? Man, it's muggy as a mug in here. This is why, hey, this is a good time to remind you guys that we're going to take the summer off. Our last episode for this season will be the second week of June. So that means we got like 7 episodes left or some shit like that. Because I can't possibly ask you guys to stay here in the summertime when you could be a Colonel Summers playing dodgeball or some shit or out camping. So it's not fair. It's not fair to ask my guests to come on the show when nobody wants to sit in here. They all want to sit outside and smoke cigarettes because it's so fucking hot. I'm sorry to say the F word, Jake. Nice shirt. Okay. One more time, give it over to DJ Spark, pretty please. Now that we're back, I'd really like to thank Barney and Anna for that awesome interview. We've been trying to get those guys on forever. And this is also a great opportunity for me to remind you guys that the radio show, Fight Church Radio, moves to Wednesday nights. And DJ Spark will be joining me. So we can just push the fucking applause button for 2 hours. That'll be great radio, I'm sure. And we're going to put it, hey, you want to come up here and sit with Jake?
Oh, my.
Yeah, it is scary. Hey, you guys, but yeah, so the radio show is going to move to Wednesday. We're going to do it from Zebulon Dax Studio. So we'll be taking the production up to the next level. And since I got to pay those guys, we're looking to pick up a couple more sponsors. So if you guys want to turn your hustle into a household name, fucks with us. How you doing, Jake? He'll protect you from it. That's what he's here, to protect you from the devil. And I'll protect you from him. And then Spark will protect you from me. All right, so I'm really excited about this next interview because it's a weird angle. And plus, my guest has an opportunity to maybe win a new car tonight. We're going to be giving away a car. Thanks to our sponsors at Pontiac for their gracious donation to our tour. Hey, y'all give it up for Lauren. Give it up for Lauren one time. Oh, and one more announcement. So next week, we're going to have a great lineup. I'm not going to tell you everybody right now, but our musical guest with motherfucking Cable Rock right here. Oh, man, those motherfuckers in the audience wasn't holding down. They was like, Cable, we got DirecTV. You're like the Rob Lowe with Cable. You're like the Rob Lowe.
Hey!
I'm DirecTV Rob Lowe.
And I'm Cable Rob Lowe.
That's so fucked up. I'm sorry. I should have saved that burn for next week. That's a good one. I just thought of it, though. You got that cricket sample then? All right. So my next guest is a man on a mission.
Hi. Hey, Jesse. Thanks for having me back.
My next guest is on a mission to save Portland from hell.
Hallelujah.
Y'all, please put your hands together for Mr. Jake Zimmerman. Come on. Not to take the high road. I want to remind everybody, on 4:20, Jesus is giving a free pass to heaven for anybody who's wearing one of those straw hats and dies wearing that straw hat, goes to heaven and gives that hat to Jesus. You can... I swear, dude, Jesus does, Jesus does not have one of those hats, and I guarantee he wants one. All right, you look nervous, Jake.
I took a nap tonight earlier, and I was tired, so I took one of my mom's Dexedrine, and I'm like kind of twitchy.
What's Dexedrine? Is that like a diet pill?
Yeah, it's her diet pill.
What? So you're pretty jacked up, huh? Just take a deep breath, bro.
Just some anxiety and face twitching.
Oh, dude, your face is totally twitching.
Yeah.
You should smoke some fucking pot, Jake.
But I don't do that.
Here, take this soothing salve and use it like dapstick.
Yeah,
it'll fix your face right up, kid.
No, it's bad for you.
It's natural. The ingredients are cannabis, arnica-infused extra virgin olive oil, like Jesus' mom, olive oil.
What?
You gotta love virgin olive oil.
Yeah. On my breadstick, I like it.
Because it's like Jesus' mom.
What?
It's an extra virgin.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
No,
I'm
it's
sorry.
Okay.
I'm not making jokes. I thought that was clever.
Yeah, it's interesting.
Sorry. Okay, so Jake.
Yeah.
With all due respect, bruh.
Yeah.
You're really bad at math.
Well, it's the it's the concept behind it.
Is that algebra 3-4? Because I never got to 3-4.
No, my.
I did see the Ghostbusters though, so I know what that one is.
My pastor helped me come up with it. So it's the whole concept behind it. He did a sermon on Sunday about marijuana and how it's bad. And then after church, we did some arts and crafts, and we came up with the sign together.
Really?
Yeah.
Hey, where do you get your printing done at? This is pretty nice.
What's that?
Where do you get your printing done at?
I get it done at over off I-5, it's Benchcraft Company. They do a good job.
Okay, so what does it mean, though? Like, what was your... I guess the easiest thing would be for you to just tell me what your pastor's sermon was about.
Okay, it was he was talking about marijuana and how marijuana, the word for marijuana in Greek is pharmakia, and that's in the Bible, and it means sorcery. And when you take marijuana, you are you're kind of practicing sorcery, and you open up demonic doors for satanic oppression.
Y'all know that shit's real. That kind of makes sense, though.
Yeah.
That's why I don't fucking smoke with Greeks. Fucking Greek sorcerers. No.
Yeah. But I do
really?
I do have some examples. Before I leave, I'd like to read.
No, I would love to hear more.
Yeah, what you unless got, you have something else you want me to.
No, we're gonna try to win you a car before I let you out of here.
Okay.
But, so you can drive your mom to appointments.
Okay.
I thought that'd be a great thing. Me and Spark got together with our sponsors Pontiac.
Yeah.
And we're gonna try to win you a car tonight.
Okay. Maybe I could do like if I win the car, I could put like the church magnet on the side of it and advertise. That'd be cool, huh?
I was just gonna say that, dude.
Yeah.
Pause not.
No.
Pause not. Why don't we have a pause not drop?
What are we talking about?
Talking about pause nots? All right, we need a pause.
I know
not.
That.
We'll get right on that. Okay, so what other facts do you have for us,
well,
Mr. Zimmerman?
I did some research just to kind of prove my pastor's point and that marijuana is bad, and so I just did some research and I pulled up a few stories that involve marijuana. And
you got them on papyrus?
I got them on.
Are those the original Ten Commandments?
No, I did them. I found them.
Shit's
on.
Shit's wrinkly as fuck.
Found them on Google.
Okay, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to say the F word.
Oh, it's all right. So
Damn, dude. Is there an earthquake right now, or are your hands shaking?
Well, it's the Dexedrine.
Man, you got spirits, bruh.
Yeah.
I might have to give you one of those Hadouken. You can get that shit at Fight Church, too. It's just as real.
What?
We can exercise demons.
Oh, okay.
Your shaky demons.
Yeah.
Get out, Jake Zimmerman, now, you shaky demon. Go back to Shakyville.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Did you ever practice do the exorcisms?
Just on stoned kids.
Yeah. There's been a lot of them in the news lately.
Exorcisms or stoned kids?
Both.
You ever smoke pot, Jake?
No, I never tried it, but my pastor did.
We should go do a dab.
What's that?
It's just like candy.
Yeah.
Except you don't have to chew it. You'll love it. You ever had like heroin?
No.
Okay, I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Back to the Dead Sea Scrolls you're holding there.
Oh, yeah. So these are just some news stories. And the common theme through all of these that you'll notice is marijuana. So here we go. This is from April 21st, 2011. Joel, and these are...
You're making me shake.
Joel Dimkowicz, a Pennsylvania man, allegedly forced his grandmother to smoke marijuana with him, threatened her life, and emptied the elderly woman's bank account, according to police. When a Scranton cop asked if he made his grandmother smoke pot, Dimkowicz said she smoked it with him because he wanted her to. He denied striking his grandmother, but noted that I might grab her arms when she tries putting her hands on me. Dimkowicz was charged with one felony and six misdemeanors, including possession of marijuana.
Was that Scranton, Pennsylvania?
It just says Pennsylvania.
I think it said the cop was from the Scranton Police Department.
Oh, that's what it says. Yeah, it says Scranton.
They got crap weed in Scranton, Pennsylvania.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, so I would probably beat my grandma up too if I had smoked that weed. Yeah, if I had smoked Pennsylvania weed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you want me to read another one?
Yeah, please.
Okay, this was February 9th of 2013. Kentucky jailers discovered a small baggie of crack cocaine hidden in the foreskin of a man who was booked into a Louisiana jail.
Oh my.
According to cops, Tony what? Banks was collared on a drug charge following a traffic stop. The 25-year-old had a water bottle with liquid codeine and a marijuana roach.
He had crack cocaine in his foreskin?
Yeah.
Okay, give me another one.
All right.
Y'all want to hear another one?
October.
Or has he proven his point yet? I don't think they're convinced. Give him another one, Jake. Please, Hammer, don't hurt him.
October 31st, 2011. A couple arrested last night. Well, because this was in the news, is how it read.
So a couple arrested 4 years and one day ago.
They were seen running naked on a Georgia roadway while tripping on LSD, told cops that they gave the drug to their dog, who was later hit by a car. The residence, police noted, was in disarray with blood on the living room carpet, money scattered on the floor, and a large bag of what appeared to be marijuana on a table. Cops also reported that the home was littered with numerous beer bottles, a water pipe, and a digital scale used to weigh marijuana. Do you want one more or two more?
One more might push me to your side, but go ahead. Give me two more.
You want two more?
Go ahead.
That one.
Okay, go ahead, Jake.
Okay, this is...
Then we're going to try to win you a car.
This one's... this starts with a quote. I am a dumbass white boy from Wisconsin. That's the best Christopher Parker, 24, could offer Chicago cops Wednesday morning after he was pulled over during a traffic stop and officers found a handgun, a stack of cash, and a load of marijuana in his SUV.
And a loaded marijuana?
Parker allegedly offered police $100,000 if they would let him go. According to a police report, he said, "I know that's more than your salary." He said, adding, "Take the car and take the money. I don't care. Just let me walk, bro. Please let me go." Along with describing himself as a dumbass, the Eau Claire resident noted that he said, "I watch Gangland, and I come to the south side of Chicago to act like a big baller. I borrowed a gun from a friend for protection, and I was scared to be driving down here. I'm on vacation with my family, and I have the gun because my girlfriend is scared too." Parker was charged with trying to bribe a cop, possession of a gun, and marijuana.
Give me one more.
Okay, this is the last one. February 1st, 2012. Valerie Bartke, 24, and Amanda Johnson, 17, Wisconsin sisters, face criminal charges for allegedly sexually assaulting a man with a pair of pliers after having forced him to drink a glass of urine.
Oh, my.
Both girls had been smoking pot. So they were doing marijuana.
It's right behind you, bro.
Do you want an almond? Yeah, I got some. My mom got me some almonds today. They're my favorite. Do you want one?
One.
Or you can have a few.
I just want one.
There you go.
You buy bulk almonds?
My mom buys them for me.
That's nuts. That's like your calling card. You probably just leave an almond everywhere you go. Here's one almond.
I have a card, too, actually.
A card?
Yeah.
An OMMP card?
My business card. What? What's so funny?
Nothing.
Do you want to share?
Nothing.
Okay. We can share.
I can't. I'm on the air. Okay, eat that fast. You can't eat on television, man.
Oh, I can't.
Okay, so these people are going to go to hell if they smoke pot, Jake?
Well, it's just risky because it opens up the door, you know, and sometimes it just doesn't close back up.
I mean, I did see the common theme in all of those crazy, insane stories. Was that the pot was the gateway drug to making people drink pee and to hiding crack in your foreskin.
Yeah.
And to beating your grandma up.
Yeah.
So I kind of see where you're coming from.
Thanks.
I do. I'm glad you came on.
So are you going to change your direction of everything you're doing in life?
Nope. I'm going to wait till the very exact last minute and I'll say, "I believe Jesus died for my sins." And I'll be wearing a cool hat. Which I'll trade Jesus for eternal salvation when I get there.
Well, that's a good that plan's kind of risky, but you know.
I'll be like, "You don't even got the new Seahawks hat. They're big these days." Jesus just has the old Seahawks hat from when they were still in the AFC. You ready to win a fucking car?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh man. Close that door. That's the hat. That's the heaven hat right there. That hat will get you to heaven. If you die right now wearing that fucking hat and you get to heaven, Jesus will be like, "You're a piece of shit. You've always done." I do like that hat though, bro.
Where? Whose?
The straw hat.
Oh, yeah.
The sombrero de Estrero. We talking about sombreros?
It was this.
What are we talking about?
The room was.
Sombreros? What are we talking about?
We're talking about sombreros.
I know that.
Sorry. You ready to win a car?
Okay.
You ready to play the game? DJ Spark, let's play that game.
Like we always do about this time.
so excited. Your mom's gonna be fucking stoked. All right, welcome to our new game. This is about the fourth week we've done it. Nobody's won a car yet. All you have to do is answer 5 easy questions.
Okay.
And DJ Sparks, show them what they'll win.
A new car! The front-wheel drive Pontiac 2000, pure driving excitement. Rim size, sleek good looks with a responsive 4-cylinder overhead cam engine and electronic fuel injection from Pontiac. It comes with California emission, AM radio, and tinted glass. Bob, Anita says she never wins.
Did you say AM radio and tinted glass?
Radio and tinted glass, Bob.
Did you say AM radio and tinted glass? Rod, right.
Tinted glass, Bob.
Your mom would like the tinted glass, probably.
What?
And the AM radio.
Pontiac 2000, pure driving excitement.
Okay, let me clarify, you guys. It's not a Pontiac 2000, as in 2000 is the year. It's a 1983 Pontiac 2000. All right, our deal with Pontiac, we're not that fresh yet, so we had to negotiate a little bit.
Neither am I.
Right? You're lucky. Second place is you get put on a mailing list when cold call you.
That's okay.
You're like, oh, sorry, you didn't win the Pontiac. But
it'd be nice to get a call.
But we gave our solicitors this whole box of your phone numbers. Okay. We got music for the questions. Okay. This is marijuana literature. So I want you to tell me what book the following quotes came from. And God said, behold, I have given you every herb-bearing seed which is upon the face of the earth, and every tree in which is the fruit of the tree yielding seed, to you it shall be for meat.
Could you repeat
what book is that from?
Could you repeat the first part?
Oh my God.
Just the first part.
And God said...
Oh, that's the Bible.
All right, that's one in a row. We got one in a row, everybody, okay? Same thing. Tell me what book this quote is from. And the earth brought forth grass, herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit, whose seed was in itself after her kind. And God saw that it was good.
It's the Bible, the God.
All right, two. We're 40% of the way to a new car. Well, new to you. And the earth brought forth grass, and herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit, and it was good. Oh. Looks like you get a bonus one.
Bible?
Oh, my God. Okay, now you got three. This is going to get a little bit harder, bro. You ready? You're on level 4. Are you scared?
Just nervous.
Do you want to call your mom on a lifeline right now?
Do you have those?
I do got your mom's phone number, though.
What?
When you were locked up, she reached out to me.
She did?
She was just like, Jake needs friends right now.
Yeah.
And I said, I'll be sure to let somebody know.
Aww.
Okay, question number 4. Now the works of the flesh are manifest.
The Bible?
Which are these? Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murderers, drunkenness, revelings, and the such like. And if I told you before, as I have told you in time past, that which they do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But you already entered the Bible, so you're right. Okay. One more, Jake. You're one more away from... What will he win, Spark?
Tinted glass, Bob.
Tinted glass, Rob. You ready?
Yeah.
The illegality of cannabis is outrageous.
Wait.
An impediment to full utilization of a drug which helps produce the serenity and insight, sensitivity and fellowship so desperately needed in this increasingly mad and dangerous world.
Can you repeat just part of it?
in this increasingly mad and dangerous world. Oh, sorry. Oh, so close, Jake.
Why?
It was the Bible.
Bible?
It was the Bible. All you had to do was say the Bible one more time. You gave up your faith, Jake. You went to Google, Jake. You tried to Google it instead of asking the Lord.
Can we do a do-over?
I'm sorry, Jake. We got to get Bad Habitat on stage. You like hip-hop, Jake?
Yeah, some of it. Gospel Gangsters, Lecrae.
And Cray?
Lecrae.
Lecrae?
Lecrae.
Is that Spanish for Cray?
No, his name's Lecrae. He's a gospel rapper. And Devil's Worst Enemy, he's good.
So we're going to go do some dabs, Jake?
If it doesn't...
You ever had like a licking stick? You know those little things where you just...
Yeah.
It's just like that. Except they just go... And you blow smoke out your eye holes.
I don't know. That sounds kind of risky.
Jesus did it. Jesus did it. Okay, so how can people find you, Jake? And then I'll let you out of here. I promise.
They can find me... at church on Sunday mornings, if they want to meet me there.
I know that.
Or if they don't want to go to meet me at church, then they can just find me on Facebook, Save Portland From Hell, or SavePortlandFromHell.com, or Jake Zimmerman on Facebook with two N's. Thanks.
Y'all give it up one time for Jake Zimmerman, please. Y'all ready for some hip-hop? Y'all pass the hat. Holy shit, you have a camouflage panty pack? I have a camouflage panty pack. We should get bunk beds. Don't step on the microphone. And Diaz will be so happy. Thank you, Jake. Y'all give it up one more time for Jake Zimmerman. One time for DJ Spark, DJ Wheels. To the engineer, Mr. Ryan McKenzie, Ian and Kobe on the bar. We're going to take a short fucking break while Bad Habitat does a quick sound check. And then. Yes, 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 yes. And don't forget, Patrick Thomas Perkins still has his special tonight. Very special tonight. Hey, what's your music on? Matt, what's the music on? Zip Drive? It's on a CD. It says 1986 on it, right? You got that, Spark?
It sounds like you're saying bad, bad habitat.
Patrick Thomas Perkins, are you almost ready? Are you like Mom Spaghetti ready? Like you on some 8 Mile comedy shit? Okay, okay,
oh, he's
okay.
A comedian?
So look, when I sat and thought about like who should I book for 420, it was a no-brainer. Yo, Pinball man, I see your knees, buddy. Nice knees.
Hey!
Man, look, so it became quickly obvious who we should book for our 420 special. Bad Habitat has, they've headlined the Hemp Stock for the last 4 years. They only rap at nighttime. Right. Right. They're real lost boys. They sleep upside down at Drew's house. I'm going to get the fuck out the way, ladies and gentlemen. Bad Habitat. Woo!
Yeah.
Yo.
Oh.
Yeah. Ready?
Yeah.
I'll do a backflip off the hood of your car. Cause I'm a blacksmith getting high with your mom. I get hella pissed when she spills a bomb. Like, damn, bitch, clean it up, I'll be late for my job. Paycheck from the mom, motherfucker, tie cop. When I'm knocking at the bar, then I start a fight club. Fight church and win down another dub. Life too, I'm perk, can I get a life buzz? I spend time my time, so the chickens get tied up. Iller than a pirate, I am just a tyrant. Knock you out first round, and I watch your eyes spin. Get in the car, motherfucker, I'm driving. Killing my bars, never look just diving. Fuck your little rock and you ain't Illuminati, for sure you ain't rhyming. Yeah. Old school rap, you just suck, better siphon.
You ain't running the game, you got no idea what it costs to gain. And if you ain't spitting the flames, the only thing you're gonna be is in our way. Cause you ain't running the game, you got no idea what it costs to gain. And if you ain't spitting the flames, the only thing you're gonna be is in our way.
I used to roll with a pound of weed, did my damn thing, sold it for 200 with an ounce of peace to make sure that my family eats. Sipping champagne, and we did this damn campaign for weeks. Got higher than the tops of the mountain peaks while we counted more money than account speed. Then we copped a lick on an ounce of cane. Then we blew more coke than a fountain drink. Home floats, but I'll drown your dreams. I flow colder than the ice down a mountain stream. Swag rappers are just clowns and me. Your skinny jean, wearing ass can't amount to me. I'll rise to the top and break the ceiling. In every city, we stay resilient. My pain, my heart, my every feeling is put in every trap to relate to millions.
You ain't put in the game, you got no idea what it costs to gain. And if you ain't spitting the flames, the only thing you're gonna be is in our way. Cause you ain't put in the game, you got no idea what it costs to gain. And if you ain't spitting the flames, the only thing you're gonna be is in our way.
Push the move and ask a man. My backpack on a mission to stack cash like NASDAQ. It's simple, like a crab scratch you ass hats. We're in problems and numbers, math class. So match that, competition is nothing weak. Heat them seeds like the chicken and dump was you. Really fun, softer than a motherfucking blueberry muffin. You carry nothing, I just deliver it. Do Willie Lumpkin, crushing on a fucking two-berry budget. I don't give a fuck if you really love it. Your opinion is a slut, it sucks dick. Bump this when you're up in your ride, ha. I'm a match shit, Optimus Prime, hot. Ready for action, rocking my rhyme. So stand back and let me boggy your mind. This ain't a game.
Running the game, you got no idea what it costs to gain. And if you ain't spitting the flames, the only thing you're gonna be is in our way. Cause you ain't running the game, you got no idea what it costs to gain. And if you ain't spitting the flames, the only thing you're gonna be is in our way.
How y'all feeling, Fight Church?
Ooh.
There's a lot of style rap going around right now. You just get on a track and say something cool with style. Well, we think that's whack.
Say something cool with style. Hey, Wills.
I'm in my Chevy.
I'm feeling a little hot over here.
Oh, on your mic?
On the mic. Feeling a little hot.
I don't know what to tell you, buddy.
I'm not even screaming like I normally am.
Yeah.
Yo, it's Bad Habitat, we back by Big Bang. Touche, like my lyrics were hands of Luke. Scotty ain't here, he finishing 2K. I'm high definition, my image is Blu-ray. I'm only two things, dope and ill. There ain't one to see out, I ain't supposed to kill. I ain't supposed to chill,
I'm a renegade zombie.
This is so live that I'm taking out a teleprompter. Feel that right, could probably jump off the range and kill a cop. But anybody's still a philosophical
holler.
This is the Harvard. Lyrical Harvard, this is lyrical bombs,
the shores of Pearl Harbor.
I am so dope,
I'm broke to burn lava.
Get so high, I'm forced to burn contra.
KRS-One,
that's what's never get farther.
Hang it in your brain like that. It's like a jungle, it's like a jungle in this habitat. Hang it in your brain like that.
Yo.
Let me paint you a visual. With every syllable I write, might take it to the fight. And it's critical hype when I'm living in the light. Just give me the light so I can get like a kite. Hit a typical hose, don't get it, bro. When we kill it at the show, spotlight till we glow. Got the crowd like, whoa, my core about to blow. And my flow is my plan to expand on my dome like a dinner roll. So sharp I can cut through glass, destroy MC's nerves like pussy gas. Hit him with a blow like a punching bag. Yo, I don't mean to brag, but most styles are a gag. Most FCs just bump their own tracks. No one of this dance full of delusional cats. Turns out that not even that important, man. Big bang and have a cat, bring the portal back. It's like, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Bang it in your brain like that.
It's like a jungle.
It's like a jungle in this habitat. Bang it in your brain like that.
It's like a jungle, it's like a jungle in the savage.
Been dope, see you don't have to mention that. Been broke, so I know how to stretch my cash.
Yo, I made a mission,
check the stamp.
Came in with a half-assed
exit plan, a rock demon.
Word to Etrigan, with delivery that's
better than a telegram.
Set your ass up, affect my crib.
I'm in boobs all day like a second hand.
So I get messed up
like a 76.
I just rock, man,
Benjamin Grimm.
Comfortable, yeah, I'm settling in, ready to win.
Plus I know where my enemies live.
You ain't telling me shit, and I accept the effect.
Then snap like a motherfucking celery stick.
It's like the less you respect us, the better we get. So watch us cruise like Penelope is.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Bring it in your brain like that. It's like a jungle, it's like a jungle in this habitat. So bring it in your brain like that. It's like a jungle, yeah, yeah, yeah. It's like a jungle in the savage,
man. Oh, yeah. 420. Make some noise for 420 right now. Oh, the crowd is going wild.
You want to switch me mics? I don't care.
You guys could switch mics.
I don't want you.
That's cute. Oh my gosh. I just witnessed something adorable.
Oh.
Oh, hey.
Oh. Sure, we could do that.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah,
sir.
We didn't switch drinks though, right?
Yeah. We're not switching drinks.
Not switching
you
drinks.
You can switch mics.
No. I don't want your drink, man.
Yeah, right.
Your drink's not yellow enough for me.
Do another song? Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Cause we are the band, the people, the fans, the evil supports that play this, and the man is sequel, so put your hands up. Like a robbery dog, we got this place packed up.
Like your arteries clogged,
yup. I use this amplified device to get the crowd arise. They concentrate my presence on the peasants till they feel alive. It's powerful, like you died and just been revived. They came back from the dead, like damn, music saved my life. Cause we're making a statement like a psycho
with a snub nose.
Strap with a bomb while they shooting up the front row. Yeah, you got that anxious feeling. So just vibe, puff, lie till your high's the ceiling. Now ain't fucking with $1 million, but I'm running with that suicide army and some lyrical scholars. Oh please, just forgive me, father. I'm about to spit vets or break bread to get high tomorrow. That's an everyday life of mine. When there's no food on the table, we're selling dope in time. Just see, don't pick your bones clean till the corpse is dry. Cause all you are is me in the vulture's eyes. Cause we are the land, the people, the fans. The equals of us play this in a man to sequel. So put your hands up like a robbery dog. We got this place packed up like your arteries clogged. Cause we are the land, the people, the fans. The equals of us play this in a man to sequel. So put your hands up
like your arteries clogged. We got this place packed up like your arteries clogged. Yeah.
You know you're feeling the modern day Bruce Willis, the heart of the Archbishop. Should we marching like a million bars? The bars are living, don't you start your vision. I can't stop your sister, I drop
kick your bitches.
Listen to the motors from the mind of a madman. Who to get you on like missiles in the middle of Baghdad. Flipping like reciprocals, a lyrical black flag. Pivotal residuals that give you a backdraft.
Yeah,
Max Mad
competition is nothing.
First I get in the booth,
then I rip the production.
Like a C4 bomb, suck the boy your cousins. I'm like a
strapped to four, you cussed.
Fuck the Fortune 500, I'm dead, I'm alive.
Running for all you whack fuckers inside that you want crutches.
Cause I can die peacefully
in my sleep, but I'd rather die for what I believe. Instead I'm running like
we are
the land, the people, the fans, the equals, the ones that play this, and the man, the sequel. So put your hands up like your robbery dog. We got this place packed up like your arteries clogged. Cause we are the land, the people, the fans, the equals, the ones that play this,
and the man, the sequel.
So put your hands up like a robber dog. We got this place packed up like your arteries clogged.
You never heard of me, I'm certain you will. I'll curb your appeal and show you how emergencies feel. Keep your contract, I am not concerned with the deal. I haven't purchased a meal since learning to steal. So just follow my rhymes like I'm playing a pipe. I never met a critic who decided what I like. I never gave a shit who was offended, it's my life. You'll never see it come when I strike a drop-by. Sideswipe like an auto pop. Call the cops. Dog, you're softer than a soccer mom. Bitch, soak up this flow like a tampon. I'm the kind of cat that's quick to take a shit in his sandbox. And we just expand like a cash crop. Tanner Rack on meth. Yeah, I am a Sasquatch. You remind me of Lieutenant Dan. Dog, you talk a lot, but you ain't got a leg to stand
cause on. We are the land, the people, the fans, the equals, the ones that play this. And demand the sequel, so put your hands up like a robbery dog. We got this place packed up like your arteries clogged. Cause we are the land, the people, the fans, the equals, the ones that play this. And demand the sequel, so put your hands up like a robbery dog. We got this place packed up like your arteries clogged.
Yup. Yep. Wow, that's a loud fucking noise for such a small establishment. These people are putting in work.
You guys want one more? Yeah? Sure. Why not?
Yeah, why not?
It's 4:20, right? All right.
I could die peacefully. I could die peacefully
in my sleep.
I could die peacefully.
Hey, yo, my church, make some noise, y'all.
I could die peacefully in my sleep, but I'd rather catch a bullet for the things I believe. Shot dead in the street, right in front of your home. When I go, I want the world to know. Yo, yo, I could die peacefully in my sleep, but I'd rather catch a bullet for the things I believe. Shot dead in the street, right in front of your home. When I go, I want the world to know. Yo, yo,
I'm about to break it down for the Northwest.
Cause my habitat's respected like some Vietnam war vets. So who's a torch next? Well, I don't know, but when they comes, a sandwich. I clean cut up like a vortex and leave them with a sore neck. Yeah, you get it if you know my homies cutting jack-o'-lanterns in your cortex. Selling CDs on your doorstep. Cause comparing us is like putting a board up against a Corvette. I'm stabbing at a sword's death. All the way down at the yard, now you're hiding like I'm shooting up your Porsche X. I get faded like plus 40s and doorsteps. I'm walking like I've been ordered in the Oregon vortex. I'm wasted, making last impressions till you came in. I'm pacing while you ramble off your accusations. My style's deep, it goes way past the basement. Wanna test me? Go ahead, dog, I'll ace it. I could die peacefully in my sleep, but I'd rather catch a bullet for the things I believe. Shot dead in the street, right in front of your home. When I go, I want the world to know. Yo, yo, I could die peacefully in my sleep, but I'd rather catch a bullet for the things I believe. Shot dead in the street, right in front of your home. When I go, I want the world to know. Yo, yo, leave your reasoning behind. See, I've been trying to find a sequence that defines the patterns of my mind's design. True, the revolution will never be achieved in my time. Still, I'm recruiting for the future troops, teaching with my rhymes. Never questioning to myself, ain't Jekyll and Hyde. When this bird spreads his wings, and when the blind lead the blind and the deaf give the orders, the only truth you'll ever find in
the deaths of you soldiers. We move cool, cause our whole lives like landslides. Give the world a cold shoulder as we pass by. Living fast lives, no concern for our last ride. To fall apart when she gets heavy like some cheap ass wife. Let your life boat capsize, learn to swim. I'll guide your path by candlelight, let it burn from both ends. No rest, no reason for the cousin of death. The pretense was never said, we all are asleep in the end. Like I could die peacefully in my sleep, but I'd rather catch a bullet from the things I believe. Shot dead in the street, right in front of your home. When I go, I want the world to know. Yo, yo, I could die peacefully in my sleep, but I'd rather catch a bullet from the things I believe. Shot dead in the street, right in front of your home. When I go, I want the world to know. Yo, yo.
Better respect than I carry the message. I carry the essence. I carry the essence.
In a matter of seconds.
I'm gathering the freshest head and I've been slapping my brain. The mag is infected. You're grabbing the medic.
Mask gonna set it.
I'm gonna tackle the fences. Do the throughout the pretenders. If you never really met it, then
you live through credit.
I'm being the peasant.
Start reading the credits.
I got a legion of MCs. So we need is a relic. Yeah. We all come equipped. We got the mic and I hit the deal. We tasting with fists. And
plus I'm high on the piss.
Yo, we live the mix, we gon' try to get rich. The whole formula's designed in my mouth
when I spit.
All we need's a paper and a pen.
We're making a hit.
No, this is what we living in.
Hope you think it's tragical. I could die peacefully if I sleep, but I'd rather catch a bullet for the things I believe. Shot dead in the street, right in front of your home. When I go, I want the world to know. Yo, yo, I could die peacefully if I sleep, but I'd rather catch a bullet for the things I believe. Shot dead in the street, right in front of your home. When I go, I want the world to know. Yo, yo,
yo.
Oh. Fight Church TV.
Yeah.
Good to be back. Make some noise for DJ Spark up here, pushing buttons for us. Good job, DJ Spark. Make some noise for your host, Ozone. And make some noise for the picketer, the weed picketer that was in here a minute ago. He seemed like a really nice guy with just a misguided cause, and I feel bad for him. So,
man, he broke down the etymology.
Aww.
Right? Yeah, man. No malice, no harm. Like Ghostbusters 2. I wasn't trying to hurt anybody. Right. No, I don't know what happened to him. He disappeared. But I'd like to thank Jake Zimmerman for having the courage to come up. Okay, so check this out.
Actually, check, bro. This ain't going to check him out.
This is the one you're going to check out right here. All right. Hey, we're doing something we've never done before at Fight Church, and I'm really excited to do this. We've gotten our technology up to the level that we're now able to provide a really nice-looking three-camera stream with a professional twist. You know, like, when you watch it, you'll be like, damn, okay, you're doing some cool shit. And it just so happens that today is the 5-year anniversary of my personal favorite Portland comedian.
What are we talking about?
We're talking about Patrick's.
What are we talking about?
We're talking about Patrick's.
I know that.
Y'all don't like those Irish jokes that much, do you? Fuck it. You love him, Spark? I love him.
It's funny to me, too.
That's my hand right here. He was too busy with his mime career. Okay, so look, what we're going to do is Patrick around. Okay, so look, and Ryan and Wheels, are you guys, like, ready for this? Okay, so I'm going to go, like, some 3, 2, 1, and we're just going to pretend we started it. Like, sorry, Patrick, I wish I would have dressed up. It was 4:20, so I just waked and baked. But whatever, so we'll start this over. We'll go right now. And then, look, I'm going to do a little intro. Spark is going to play some music for you. You're going to come up, let the music play, dance a little jig. You got this X on the floor right here, okay? So just come up and try to stay next to the X and use this mic that I just coughed on. You can just polish it like an apple. Okay. What camera are we on? Camera one? All right. 3, 2, 1. Hey, welcome back to Fight Church.
Give it up for DJ Spark on the ones and twos. All right, so now we got a very special opportunity tonight. Tonight is the 5-year comedy anniversary of a very good friend of the show, and we're pleased that he spent his 5th birthday with us. With no further introductions, Mr. Patrick Thomas Perkins.
And begged you not to leave because I go berserk. Well, you left me anyhow, and then
you guys keep clapping for Jesse for doing fight church for a kind of tattoo. See, and then in post we're gonna isolate that clapping, and I'm just gonna put it over all the jokes so it sounded like I did good. That's my plan for tonight. Awesome. I'll give you an example of how that's going to go. You guys give it up for Cadigans for existing. So you just clap now, right? All right. Cool. Give it up for the DJ. Yay! I have actually been doing comedy for 5 years. I got stoned 5 years ago and was like, I should go to a bar and annoy a bunch of people. And that's not really a business plan, but it has been fun. That's for sure. I remember my first joke. I got in front of a bar at an open mic, and I was like, hey, everybody, I'm a little bit nervous. I normally do this in front of my dog and cat, naked. Clever writer right from the start. That's how I've been. Yeah. I like to build up. It's a lot like child neglect. Like, I like to build up with a slow start, and then eventually I realize I've lost all of you. Like, that's how my sets go. I'm already happy. I do, for those of you who don't know, I do sad jokes, which means, like, I like to, at the end of my set, you're not going to know if you should laugh or hug me. It's okay to do both. You laugh now, we'll hug later. It's where the smoking circle will be. It's awesome. I have been doing comedy for 5 years, and they say 5 years, they say 10 years is actually the exact amount of time it takes to make an overnight success. What they don't tell you is 5 years is the exact amount of time to figure out that's not going to be you. That's like, that's, I'm at a point where, like, I totally love doing comedy, but I totally hate my entire act. Right? Like, I don't have any teeth, and those jokes just lack bite. That's a fact. I'm missing 3 vertebrae. Those jokes, they don't stand up on their own very well. I've been married and divorced twice, and I might have romanticized those jokes, but I don't fuck around with them anymore. That's just how it is. I have depression, and those jokes have killed them. Like, they just kill themselves halfway through every time. I had to take suicide jokes from my act and cut them. They'd leave people hanging. What I'm saying is, you can overdose on suicide jokes. It can be a real shot to the head. And then afterwards, there's all these new. God, why do I like to make things so depressing? I don't know. This is what I call fun. Like, I like getting as sad as possible, because to me that means, like, I know what happiness is later. You know, like, it's like I said, it's not much of an adult plan, but it's totally a plan. Like, it's what I do. Like, I don't pick jobs based on the fact that I might enjoy them or they'll pay me well. I pick them, like, on the fact that I don't have a boss and they might be fun. Like, that's. Like, I was a strip club DJ for 3 nights. 3 nights. Here's how you'd be a strip club DJ for 3 nights. You introduce the girl, you leave to smoke a cigarette, and then you go back up, introduce the girl again, and leave to smoke a cigarette. Manager was like, dude, why didn't you stick around? I was like, hey, man, I didn't want to, like, stare at the chicks. I thought that would be rude. Like, that's not what I'm here for. The other problem is, like, I'm not good at addressing women in that sexy way, you know? Like, you're supposed to be like, the sexy tits on Kimberly, yeah! Right? Like, look at the ass jiggle on Amber! And I would do things like, look at the intimidating personality in Barbie! Oh my god, she has a real job and makes more than me, it's Tiffany! I am actually really bad at a bunch of jobs. Like, I was a used car salesman for a while. That was weird. Because I would, like, first off, I get nervous when I talk to people one-on-one. And my boss was like, hey, man, how do you fix that? Like, what do you do? Because he knew I did stand-up. So he's like, how do you get over that for stand-up? And I was like, hey, man, I smoke as much weed as I can. Like I will smoke, like, 2 fields of weed before a set. And he's like, all right, from now on, that's company policy. That's, like, if there's a customer, I want to see smoke signals coming out of the garage. That's where we're at, right? And turns out that's not a great company policy, because when I get really stoned, I do this awesome thing that you're not supposed to do as a car salesman. I tell the truth, right? You get a flying metal death box through lies. That's exactly how cars work. Like, you come in and you lie to me about how much money you have, right? And then I lie to, like, I take your lies you've taken to me, right? And I lie to you about anything, like, the grass is purple, the sky is green, that car works. Like, lies like that. Right? And then we combine lies, I take them to a manager who takes your lies, mixes them with my lies, makes up his own lies, hands them to the bank. Bank just full of lies. Like, that's their whole business model, money and lies. It's a lot like some people's, like, spouses. It's an interesting model. All right. I've lost you enough there, I feel like. I'm comfortable that I've lost you all that. I'm miserable. But here's the thing. I'm also a happy person. Like, I have things about me that make me really happy. Like, I am an amazing porn clerk. All right. And here's part of why I'm an amazing porn clerk. I didn't have sex in high school. That's like really where it comes down to, because, like, all my friends, they were getting laid, they were having it, and I was doing this awesome thing. The internet had just come out, there was all these websites, so I just researched the shit out of sex. All right, like, I'm at a point where I can take apart and put back together a vagina blindfolded. That's, like, I'm at some next level shit. Here's how good I am at, like, sex and porn clerking. I sold a woman a fleshlight. All right, for those of you who don't get what I just said, I sold a woman with a real vagina a fake vagina. All right, that would be if, like, Optimus Prime had shown up at the car lot, and I was like, hey, dude, I got the 97 Hyundai, like, Odyssey for you, and he drove away in it. Like, that's some, I'm so good at porn clerking, and I hate it so much. It is like love, I think, is what it is. Jesus. I am glad all 9 of us are here. I feel like that makes it nice and intimate. I did a house party recently where there was, like, the cops got called, but, like, not because our house party was so crazy, but because nobody ever came to this house ever before. Like, they just show up, and it was in Washington, so I was, like, in the backyard, like, I can smoke weed legally, yay, right? And I see cops at the door, and I'm like, oh, shit, they know, right? And then instead, they're just like, yeah, we just wanted to make sure everyone wasn't, like, being a dick, and we weren't. It was awesome. I don't go on the road a whole lot for comedy because I have a kid, which shouldn't astound you as far as, like, I have had sex. Like, I know, like I said, I know how it works, right? And I have a 10-year-old son. He's super cool, but he's, like, the other day he was hanging out with me, and he was sitting on the chair, playing video games, and he has the exact same, like, shoes as me on, right? And he's getting really into his level, and he flips up his hood. Like, he's like, yeah, like, fucking into, like right when he jumps into the cave, and he's like, mission time, the same way I do. And my roommate's like, dude, your kid, like, he is totally you. And I'm like, dude, my kid is 10, and I see him 3 weekends a month. Like, I'm immature. That's what this is. That's not, like, and I'm not, like, I am not a bad dad. I just didn't want to be a dad. There's a big difference, right? Like, if you're a bad dad, you do things like my dad did, which was like tell me things like, I'm not racist. I just, I don't hate the black people anymore. I just hate the towel heads. And then you don't say black people. Like, that's a terrible thing to do to your kid. I don't, like, I normally have a better bit about that, but I was like, I'm just going to throw it out there. Why not? I can edit all of this so it seems like people cared, right, Jesse? Sweet. Don't worry. No, I don't. No, I believe you. I'm in front of the camera, and I'm like, yeah, this is where life has brought me. Yes! Oh, I'm like, get his goal, though. He's 10, and he'll try to tell me jokes and shit. And he came up, like, I grounded him from video games. I was like, you have to come up with a game of your own. And he's like, okay, my game is we go to the future and we kill monsters. I'm like, how are you going to do that? And he's like, I don't know. We just go to the future and kill monsters. That's how we do it. But he's weird because he's in, like, a Christian school, so he's not, like, he gets, like, reading and writing, you know, and math and, like, that's it. Like, that's about it. Like I have to take care of science and sex ed. That's been weird. I had to, like, here's the thing. I'm not a shitty dad. I'm a weekend dad, which means I'm just a Redbox dad, right? Like, each weekend, me and my kid get to pick a new genre, and we get to be that, right? Like, hey, let's be sci-fi action adventure this weekend. All right. Let's be family drama this weekend. All right. Let's be dad's just poor enough to buy you food from the dollar store this weekend. Yeah. Like that's... that sort of thing. But it does mean that, like, we have a real cool relationship where we see each other just enough that, like, we know we love each other, but not so much that we can actually blame each other for anything, right? like he knows I'm not there, so it's not my fault if anything goes wrong, right? And he's not around much either, so it's like I can't blame him for, like, this. Like, this is it's all on me, right? But I do care about him, and I do try to impart on him, like, my kind of better view of the world, because I firmly believe that, like, overall, more than anything else, just don't be a dick. Like, that's, like, if you're shitty, say sorry. Thank you, Aaron. Thank you, guy I know. But I do believe that, and so I try to impart that on my kid, and, like, he came up to me one time and was like, hey, Dad, I want to know what gay is. And I was like, that's fucking awesome, because, like, I'm going to be the one to teach you that. Sweet. All right, dude. You know how your mom and your stepdad love each other? Yeah, that's gay. That's all that is. That's all the fuck that is. Yeah. I had to give him a scarier lesson recently because he was staying the night and he moved a blanket in his sleep. Like, he was in the bed and he rolled over and, like, my kid's boner moved a blanket, guys. Like, that's... and it wasn't, like, snuffleupagus. Like, it wasn't massive. Like, it was small and fear. Like, I was proud. I was like, that's my boy. And then I was terrified because I was like, oh, shit, I have to tell him what to do with that. And he exists, so I don't know what to do with that. Fuck. Right? So I decided to do what I always do, which is I give him the talk, right? I give him the conversation, and we're driving along, and I say, hey, dude, do you know what sex is? And he goes, yeah, kind of. And I'm like, all right, sweet. I don't have to have the real talk with you. Awesome. There's two things you should know, though, kiddo. First thing is get permission. Like, just get really good at saying please. Like, that's number one. But number two, whatever you do, whoever you love, however you love them, just don't come in vaginas. Because that's how babies are made. That's how lives are destroyed. That's why we're having this conversation. Don't forget to grab your homework on your way into your mom, dude. I'll see you next weekend. Father of the year, that's me. I have a terrible example for a father, personally. Like, my dad was really racist, like, for real, to the point where, like, I think it might have been a superpower, right? Like, my dad died for a day. Because, and I'm fairly positive, like, they gave him, like, the little CPR thing, and then they just saw the swastika and, like, just tapped it, and he was like, ah! And it, like, it makes me weird because, like, I've never thought to, like I have a lot of stuff so wrong with me that, by comparison, I don't see how I could judge anyone as inferior. Like, that's too wordy to be a real joke. Mostly it's just sad. I'm bringing it up at Thursday on therapy. I have notes, and I mostly have notes because it is 4:20. Love weed. Let's give it up for weed. Yay! I actually kind of agree with that guy, though. Like, weed has fucked my life up a little bit, you know? No, for real. Because, like, if it wasn't for weed, I wouldn't know what peanut butter and Doritos taste like. Like, that's... and that's a good goddamn taste. Like, I'll be honest. If it wasn't for weed, I would have, like, a wife and a real job, and I would, like, be going places in life. So, yeah, no, maybe weed isn't a positive influence. I don't know. Yeah, Pat, don't write improvisational material while you're up on stage. That's fine. Like, I haven't, like, here's the thing. I've been stopped by the police one time. I don't know, whatever. I can tell stories. I don't care. I was at an open mic one time, and I got stopped in front of the open mic for trying to unlock my own bike. Like, they were like, we think you're stealing that. And I was like, well, I was loading a bull, so just think that. Like, that's fine. Think that. And they're like, well, here's the deal. We want to search you. But we're just going to do it in front of your comedian friends. So here's the deal. If you say no, we're just going to put you in the car and take you to jail. I'm like, all right, but here's the deal. My mom's an idiot and just gave me a bunch of pills, and I just bought a bunch of weed. So you're going to look in my bag and see a bunch of pills and a bunch of weed. And their response was, all right, well, as long as you're being honest with us. That was, well, that and, like, I showed them the giant hole where I'm missing three vertebrae, like that. You guys, if you want to get out of drug charges, just get rid of three vertebrae. That's all you have to do. I really shouldn't improvise. I agree with you. Shouldn't. I am missing three vertebrae, and I've been missing them, like, not since birth. Basically, what happened was I was born with a tumor, and the 80s really fucking suck. That's what happened. So I have what looks like the rough draft of an asshole above my actual asshole right there. Kept me out of porn for years now. And I've tried. It's awkward. It's like, here's the thing. I've tried to fill that hole with weed smoke, and it's not working. Like, I've done that for sure. It is weird though, because like growing up, my mom would call me a miracle baby because I could walk. Like, she was like, "Oh, you can walk. It's a miracle." But I'm gonna be honest. Round of applause. Who in here can walk? Like, all of you should be clapping. Exactly. That means it's not a miracle. That's just par for the course. And what happens when God shows up to work hungover? Like, it's just like, that one's good enough. They might do a recount later, but whatever. Like, normally I have way less energy, so I'm glad I'm selling all of these. I like the porn store. I like the weird part about working in the porn store to me is that I'm totally the person that's like, that's trans. That's not tranny porn, that's trans porn, you know. I'm totally the guy that if somebody comes in and they ask for gangbang porn, like, I ask them if they turn it down so it seems like it's her idea. Like, that's, I don't know, it's weird. The weirdest part for me, though, is I used to work in the porn store 8 years ago, right? And in that time, like, time hasn't been kind to me. I've lost teeth and hair and hope, right? But I look at some of these chicks in these porn movies, and they actually look not only the same, but better. Like I don't know if you guys know this, sex is a hell of a workout. Like, that's, like, it'll get you in good shape if you're fucking, like, 9 people a week on average. Like, that's some abdominal strength, that's some leg shit. So, like, basically, I look at the porn the same way, like, Matthew McConaughey did in Dazed and Confused, where I'm just like, oh, man, I keep getting older. They keep saying the same cause of a broken society that still brings us together in a weird, masturbatorial sense. My jokes aren't for everyone. Like, I know the internet's happening, too. I love doing shit like this because, like, even if you get, like, if I get one or two of you to laugh, that's a win. But I know at the same time, somebody's probably watching this on the internet, which means I've beaten out porn, right? And not just porn, but, like, internet porn. Like, all of the porn ever. And somebody was like, nah, I need to hear about that guy and his sad dick and weed jokes. Let's. So, hi, internet. And mom. I find it weird. Like, I do get accused. Like, I only have one newspaper credit after 5 years. And it's the Willamette Week. And they say, Patrick Thomas Perkins, he has jokes about weed. And I say, the Willamette Week, they can state the obvious. That's my review of them. But my real addiction is actually Magic the Gathering. That's just thank you. It's sad, and I realized how sad it was when this dude came up to me at the porn store and was like, hey, man, do you have any heroin? Right. And he wasn't, like, it wasn't part of a pitch. Like, he wasn't like, hey, and I know where you can get some Bob's Discount Heroin Jacket. Right? Like, no, he asked me if I liked heroin the same way I traditionally ask people if they like Magic the Gathering. Like, hey, man, you might be into this, but don't kick my ass if you're not. Like, And, like, we're not that different because, like, I've bought a bunch of Magic cards. Like, I've bought, like, hundreds of Magic cards at once, kept the good ones for myself, and then sold off the shitty ones for supply. Right? I've traded DVDs for Magic cards. Like, we're both chasing dragons, just mine's on paper. And in fact, worst case scenario, that guy can get help, right? Like, if things are really bad for that guy, worst case scenario, that guy's addicted to heroin, right? Worst case scenario for me, I play Magic the Gathering, and I could still get addicted to heroin. Looking for the bright side. I feel weird. By the way, there was a lady here that was topless earlier, right? Like, that wasn't my... That was totally happening. Okay, I fucking love that about Portland. Like, this is... Like, I'm from Portland, and I moved to Sacramento when I was, like, 3, and then I came back when I was 8. So I can totally do the hipster thing of, like, I was from Portland before I was from Portland, and, like, basically I'm the most Portland person in Portland sometimes. Feels like, right? Like, I drive a scooter and I'm 30. That's pretty... Actually, that's just sad. That's mostly what that is. Because I don't do it for, like... I don't do it because, like, 7-Eleven is too far away, right? I do it because 7-Eleven takes EBT. That's why I have a scooter. And I had it stolen one night from the porn store while I was there. And it led to the most Portland moment in my life. Because, basically, I step outside the porn store to smoke weed. Because it's Christmas night, because God really can hate you sometimes, right? And I step outside, and my scooter is gone, and I yell at the top of my lungs. And my store's on 82nd, so I figure somebody hears me, but nobody does, so I finish smoking my weed. And then I make the 3 calls you make when your scooter gets stolen. I call the police, right? And I'm like, hey. Well, no, somebody's got to, like, fuck you. We'll get to that in a minute, all right? Secondly, I call my insurance company. I'm like, hey, guys, it turns out God hates me as much as we thought. I need that money I've been giving you. And then thirdly, I called my mushroom guy. And I was like, hey, dude, my scooter's been stolen. Fuck reality. Like, that's what it did. And the police came. And, like, the police took an hour and a half to get there, which means, like, anything could have happened. But my favorite part is they leave, and I see the street they go down. So after work, when I go to look, I don't go down that street because that seems stupid, right? I go home. I take my mushrooms. I have to walk to them. And on my walk back, I'm not going to take them. You know, I do that thing that you always do when you get mushrooms where you're like, I'm not going to eat these. Like, all of them. Right now. Today. Oh, shit, they're gone. Whoops. All right. I guess I'm doing that. And while I'm sitting there, like, starting to trip out, I get a text message. My best friend lives in a van or a bus. Sorry, let me make that more Portland. My best friend lives in a bus. His girlfriend is a stripper. She called Coin6 News and was like, hey, my friend's a comedian who's a porn clerk, and it gets sadder. Would you like to interview him? To which she said to me, hey, Pat, Coin6 News wants to interview you real bad. To which I said, I think not right reality. Whoa, what a concept. Turns out, if you go to write a letter to Coin6 News saying, hey, we have to interview tomorrow because I'm tripping balls on mushrooms, you won't make apologies you didn't know you needed to make. I apologize for shit in kindergarten. And then I say, but tomorrow I'll meet you guys at the store and we can, like, take establishing shots or whatever. Like, yeah, it's fine. So I get a little bit nervous, and like I do when I get nervous, I go to smoke weed. So I get off the bus like a block later, and as I walk down the block that I saw the cop drive down, my scooter was there. So I called the cops, and I was like, hey, guys, I did the hard part of your job. Like, I just looked down the one way you went. All right, so I go up to Coin6 News, and I'm like, yeah, it turns out it's right over there. We take pictures in front of the house, and they're like, do you want to go confront the owner of this house? And I'm like, no, I'm going to wait till the cops get here, right? And the cops get there, and they take the report, and they're like, all right, we're glad you got back. And as they're doing that, this car pulls into the house, and it's clearly, like, the people that live there, right? And they see me talk to the cops, and see the cops look at me, and the cops are like, do you want to talk to them? And I'm like, oh, no, this is going to get funner. Like, this is going to get awesome. Because, like, I don't like to drink and drive. Like, it's the thing. I've had friends that have died that way. Like, it's shitty, right? But I really don't like to drink and drive on the scooter because, like, I don't have a sense of balance. I'll fall down and, like no matter what, I'm missing three vertebrae, so any accident means I don't walk away from it, right? But some accidents are worse than others, so I don't want that. So what I'm going to do is, like, you know, on the weekends when I want to get wild and crazy, go back to that house, knock on the door, be like, hey, guys, Red Robin, that's the scooter's name. He's telling me how much fun he had here last weekend. I was just wondering if you guys could watch him. I'd go get crazy. All right, thanks. I have a lot of jokes with, like, a long workup to no real payoff. It's, you can ask my ex-wives. It's a lot about that. It's me all the time. I don't hate myself. I might seem like I hate myself. I don't. I think everybody should learn to love themselves, and then you'll learn to, like, love people better. And I'm working on loving myself better. But at the same time, I really did used to hate myself. And then I got divorced. That's true. But that's not, like, that's totally not on her. It's just, it's a lot easier to hate yourself if there's someone there who agrees with you. About everything. Like, hey, honey, you want to go to a movie? Yeah. Hey, honey, do you want to go to dinner before that movie? Yeah. Hey, honey, do you want to hate Pat all day, every day? If you insist. And as you've seen my act, I've insisted. I've insisted everybody hates me to the point where the bar is emptied out. It's awesome. This is great. This is how I like to really perform, because now the real magic happens where they miss it and the true survivors stick around. So you guys give yourselves a round of applause. Yeah. And then, see, I'm going to cut the stumbly part out later, and it's going to look like that joke was really good. That's how that works. Jesus Christ. Oh. I do have notes. It's because I smoke weed, like I said. I have a hard time, like, trying to date, and it's, I think it's mainly because I have a penis. I think that's what it is. And if you've never had a penis, basically what it's like is, like, the biggest dick roommate ever, right? It's messy. It's up all the time. It's constantly trying to fuck your girlfriend. Like, it's no, like, I don't like making life decisions with that. That seems terrible, right? And it's compounded by the fact that I was raised pretty much exclusively by women, right? Like, alongside my sister, I was raised by my mom, my grandma, and my aunts. Which means by the time I was 13, I was there for my sister's first period, my mom's menopause, my aunt's births and miscarriages, all right? My grandma's hysterectomy. I said the age is wrong, but whatever. My point is, before I could get erections, I experienced the life cycle of a woman, all right? And I would never, ever be the person to be like, oh, I know what it's like to be a woman, but I know what it looks like. And what it looks like is I am the worst thing that could ever happen to a woman. I am a man. And if you don't believe me, all right, go to the library tomorrow. All right, there's a book on it you can find there. It's called History. All there in black and white, and it will tell you that the three worst things that have ever happened to women are men, other women, and wolves. And how it breaks down is men invented rape and murder, women are still human, and wolves eat us both. That's history in a nutshell. Thank you guys for joining Dr. Pat's history class. Next, I'll be giving sex ed where I tell you, just don't cry too much in front of them and you should do fine. Jesus Christ. I actually, like, here's a weird thing. I'll do this one. I lost my virginity to a dude, which is, it makes things awkward, but it's like, what happened was I dated this chick in high school, and she told me if I loved her, we could have sex. And I didn't want to lie to her. And I was like, I would love having sex with you. That seems like an honest answer. It seems good. And she's like, no, you have to leave. And so all my friends gave me shit because they were like, hey, dude, you didn't lie to a woman to have sex. That's gay. That's not, like, that's not how that works. And so, like, I met a dude, and he was into magic, you know. He introduced me to Tool, smoked some weed, and then I found out I'm not as gay as everyone had told me. That's how that goes. I did have one positive experience from it, which is I realized my penis was not as small as I thought. Because I feel like the odds of two dudes hooking up and neither of us just pointing and laughing means, like, I did okay in that department. I just tell that joke to make my dad proud. That's. I hope you're watching at home, Pop. I do sometimes wish my own son was gay. I think that would be awesome. But I do worry because, like, I'm not around much. So I know he wouldn't have a like, strong... Like, I don't want my kid to get hit when he's an adult. That's my worry. I won't improvise anymore. I swear to God. I will just stick to the words I've told myself are kind of like jokes. I had this happen recently. I had someone tell me I was a cute kind of feminist boy. And as a 30-year-old man, that actually made me feel very marginalized. And sexy. Like, I'll be honest, I was sexy. Like, feminism is sexy to me, and here's why. Because I used to be one of those really insecure guys that thought the only way you could get a blowjob is if you spent $100 on dinner, right? And then I would never negotiate the blowjob part. Like, I would never bring that up. And that's stupid, because I'd honestly thought feminists were the people that wanted to get rid of the blowjob, and it turns out feminists want to get right to the blowjob, right? They want to get to the part where they're like, you're awesome and I'm awesome. Let's be honest, awesome together, right? And do away with monetary value on this thing. Like, preach, Pat, preach. Yeah, I know. Preach it. I'm just saying, I have a weird thing when I date women, when I try to anyhow, which is like I have all of that family history, and I have this weird thing where I totally want to respect them as people way more than I want to. Like, I feel like if I tell you I want to have sex with you, that's an insult, because I've been me my whole life, right? And I know what putting up with me is like. So it gets weird. Also, because, like, I have anxiety and I overthink things. So, like, if I go up to a woman, there's a woman right here, and I want to be like, hi, ma'am, you're pretty. I couldn't do that. Because if I do that, that means I'm probably going to want to ask her out on a date. If I want to ask her out on a date, that's just an interview to have sex, all right? That means I've thought about having sex with her, and I don't even know her name. That means I've committed a mind felony. Tom Cruise is going to kick open that door, going to issue me a Minority Report SVU, and I'm going to go to some weird thought prison. It's going to be terrible. Oh, yeah, I feel like I've just about burnt you guys out. I'm good. Like, this is what my kid has to put up with, dude. There's this, you guys have the exact same expression he has when he's like, yeah, Dad, you're still talking. Why? Like, I could be playing Pokemon. Oh, Jesus. I find doing comedy in Portland really weird, because I do believe that, like, we're all awesome and we're all cool and we should express that. But at the same time, like, I think sometimes you're going to say something shitty or stupid and you don't mean to, right? Like, I've been doing comedy a long time, and I've heard a lot of really stupid rape jokes be, like, forced on people. Right? And I don't like them. However, part of the reason I became a comedian is, like, I stay being a comedian, is somebody told me that I told them the only example of a rape joke where they laughed. And what it was is, like, I laugh at stupid shit all the time. I'm fucked up in the head. Like, you guys have heard me for the last 10, 15 minutes. Like, I'm not normal, but at the same time, I will laugh at fucked up shit for weird reasons. And here's the thing, I will laugh at a rape joke because, like, I'm not a narcissist, right? Like, I don't picture it happening to me. Like, if I hear a rape joke, it's not my loss of power. It's like, what I do is I picture it happening to the person telling it, right? And then it's like that's awesome. And in fact, if you want to actually, like, learn how to completely laugh at it, just picture the next time you hear a rape joke, just picture it happening to me, right? And now I've consented to it, which means it's not just a rape joke. It's just a shitty joke, and they need to write better. So, like, Portland points. Yay. I'm going to look away from you guys in shame and pretend I said none of that. That'll describe most of high school also. I normally do that joke way better. I really am out of it. There's a lot of weed in here. And I do love weed. And in fact, like, even if I'm dating someone, like, weed is pretty much my permanent life partner at this point, right? Like, I've never broken up with weed because weed thought I was too nice to other weed, right? Like, weed has never cheated on me. If I find out weed is at my friend's house, I just go to my friend's house and get stoned. That's what I do. Right. Weed has never taken my French fries from me. This has never done that. And in fact, actually, women encourage me to eat all the time. The only time, the last time, both things. No, it's fine. It's like a joke. Don't worry. The only time I sent a woman a dick pic, her only response was, like, you need to eat a sandwich, dude. So weed has never said anything to make me cry. I feel like that's a good thing. But people say you can't love weed. That's an addiction. And I'm going to cry bullshit on that. All right? Because an addiction is when you do something and your brain creates these chemicals and your body grows dependent upon them and comes to crave them. And love is when you do something and your brain creates these chemicals and your body grows dependent upon them and you come to crave them. And life is a choose your own adventure, so just fucking choose love. That's, yay, crazy, wee. All right. Jesse, I don't know how long I've been. I'm just going to end with a story, a final sad story. Because I really do, like, there's a lot of sad stories here, and I really do feel like the winner in all of them, and that's the thing you guys should recognize, all right? A lot of people think I'm a pessimist because I talk about sad shit. The fact of the matter is I don't see things as glass half empty or glass half full. I see them as glass half broken, all right? Like, shit is fucked up. Just deal with it. Right, and I'll give you a perfect example of a glass half broken situation. I did own a scooter. I said that wrong earlier. My scooter got backed up over by an idiot. All right, and I love that scooter for a lot of reasons. The biggest reason of which is all of the laughs it gave me. All right, because I wear a lot of riding gear. I would wear like riding pants and a riding hoodie and a helmet and gloves. And I'd pull into a gas station and people would just start laughing maniacally because I'd have to take all that off to put gas into it myself, right? And then I would laugh because I would get change on $5 that was usually like $3. And that was gas for a week, right? And the other reason I loved it is because, like, I felt like a badass. I really am missing 3 vertebrae. I mention it every show. And yeah, it does get annoying to see all my shows. But here's the thing, not nearly as annoying as missing 3 fucking vertebrae. That's just how that shit goes. But the scooter totally gives me that feeling of badassery. I feel like I can fly on it. And like for the longest time, I was actually thought motorcyclists hated me because they would do this thing when we rode by. Like, they go, and I thought that meant, like, I'm going to fucking kill you later. And it just means, like, what's up, dude? So, like, that was a cool reassurance. So I love that thing more than, like, probably at least myself, definitely my magic collection, like somewhere in there, right? And this idiot just backs up over it, and I respond the only way I can with, what the fuck, no! Because, like, God has done enough to me at this point, right? And they, not only do they back up over it, though, they stop, and then they back up over more. So they have the initial crunch, boom, bah, right? And they're like, nah, that's not enough. Right, and I keep yelling, and I'm like, fuck you, fuck this, and I start chasing them because I see a stop sign at the top of the hill, and I figure if you're a big enough asshole to run over somebody's scooter, you're not going to stop at this stop sign. You're going to keep going, right, because that's what assholes do. And instead, they stop like a fucking idiot, right, and I do the only thing I can do, which is jump in the back of their truck like a shitty Batman, right? Like, just fucking, and then I start kicking and punching the back of their truck, right? Because I'm like, fuck you, just, like, I'm wearing padding, right? So if they get out and kick my ass, it's not going to hurt that much, right? Plus, they've ran over my scooter. If they kick my ass, that's felony assault. I win the white trash lottery known as insurance, right? So, like, pa-ching. And instead, I look inside, and there's actually a very small, attractive woman, right? And I get scared because at this point, if you run up into and jump and started punching the back of a fucking small, attractive woman's truck, you're the felon. Doesn't matter the circumstances. I get super scared until she looks in the rearview mirror like it's Thursday. Like, that's just how things go, and says, oh, no, I'm not stopping, and fucking floors it, right? And I get super nervous, except here's the thing. Like, I don't, like, it's not a terrible situation. She's right there. I can still stop her, right? Like, I can still do something. So I'm like, hey, man, when the police pull us over, they have way more questions for you than they will for me. And she stops, and she pulls over. And here's the thing that really pissed me off, was she didn't say she was sorry at all. Right? Like, she was like, I was just having a bad day, and I didn't want to deal with this shit. I looked her dead in the eye and I said, ma'am, I'm sorry. I'm 30, and that scooter's the closest thing I own to property. This is actually almost a good day for me. Like, this is fantastic. And then I got her information. Surprised she didn't want to go to the show afterwards. That was a bit of a shocker. But on my way back, I started laughing maniacally because I've mentioned it already. I've been married and divorced twice. And that is actually the most work I've ever put into getting a woman's number. So, all right. You guys have been awesome. I appreciate all of your time and wasting it. And thank you. Give it up for everyone else here!
The only dude in town that I'm scared to hug. I must break you. I would just fucking crush you. If I just came up, gave you a homie hug, you would just die. Just snapping back like a fucking Sasquatch tree. You guys want to know a fucking funny story? That's actually Spark's ghost noise. That's not a fucking ghost noise. Y'all give it up one more time. Y'all give it up one more time, please, for Mr. Patrick Thomas Perkins. I guess we could just edit out your fucking noise. I think the show's over. In fact, I'm pretty sure the show's over. So let's do this. Let's do this one more time, y'all. Give it up for DJ Spark, Mr. Brian McKenzie, DJ Wheels, Ian, Cody, and all the other fucking straight white dudes that we have working on our show. We have to get somebody. Ashanti. Do you want to just, you don't have to do anything on our show. We just got to go, what the fuck are you talking about? Ashanti works here. Look, we got rid of the only black guy, and the only lady that worked on the show they don't work on. But you know what? Only just white dudes can hang out here. That sucks so bad. We got to change our shit because at the end of the show, I give it up for like 7 white people. Give it up for Marley. Alright, you guys don't gotta go home. The party will continue. After this is over, we can all go back to Ian's house. Ian will dab everybody out because it's 4:20. And he's got an 18-person bunk bed.
What are we talking about?
We're talking about bunk beds. peace out, y'all. See you next week. Next week we'll have a high school teacher from Wilson High School talking about those crazy tests that are being forced on our fucking kids and the bullying going on. We'll have Jake Neely, local medical grower, mad as fuck about 91 passing, trying to blame me for some shit. We'll talk about it. We'll have Sam Miller, a comedian from Seattle, coming down, fucking with us.